Thank you, Dave, for the introduction too, and I appreciate Clint also suggesting me to do this presentation. It's an honor to be able to do this presentation for you guys tonight. Just a little bit about myself. I'm just going to get to this next slide here. See if that'll work. All right. Just a little bit about myself. I'm actually from Iowa. I moved here to Colorado when I was 12, and went to middle and high school at Manitou Springs, and graduated from high school there. And it was really there at the foot of Pikes Peak where I fell in love with nature and started my hiking adventures, and had a little Kodak camera at the time that I used to go out on the trails and just take various pictures. So I fell in love with Colorado immediately, and have done a lot of hiking and camping with my family, and photography just presented itself as a natural way to capture and share with others what I was seeing, and to be able to present that in a format that was memorable to me, and hopefully memorable to other people. From there, I ended up going on to Colorado State University up in Fort Collins, and got my degree in microbiology. And I actually am working as a microbiologist now at Penrose Hospital in Colorado Springs, part-time. I work half-time at the hospital still, and do photography, and have been able to cultivate my landscape photography part-time also. And yes, I do actually do COVID testing. That's a huge part of my job right now. As you may know, with all the COVID testing that's going on in the state, and we do that at my facility. So that's been going well. I did start shooting digital about 11 years ago on a trip to the Grand Canyon. I had a little point and shoot Canon camera back then, and always wanted to figure out how I could get a more artistic and be more creative with my photography. And it just happened that Canon was there, and they were doing a rim tour, and they were allowing us to pick any of the cameras that they had available at the time and go on a rim tour with a guide. And he took us off of automatic mode and put us on manual mode, and had us change to various settings. And I was addicted after that. I came home and decided I wanted to do photography, and invested in my first DSLR at the time. I did begin selling my work about 9 years ago, and created my website. You can find me at either fineartbywendy.com, or like Dave said, it's wendygadak.com. Also, that'll get you to my site either way. I participated in art shows. I'm part of the Colorado Springs Photography Learning Group. I've been self-taught. I've taken a lot of workshops. I read several books to gain my knowledge. But I also, of course, my greatest teacher has been getting out in the field and practicing every chance I can get to try and trying new techniques. I've also learned from some other photographers that I highly recommend some of their courses. Some of them, like Sean Bagshaw, has some great courses, and I've used some of the TK actions that he has great lessons on, and he's a great teacher. Also, Nick Selway, I've followed his work for a long time, among various other artists I've followed, including Sarah Marino and Jennifer Renwick, you guys who may have seen her presentation last week. So various other photographers that I've followed, and either bought some of their instructional materials or just learned on my own. I've had several award-winning photos that have been published in Outdoor Photographer magazine, and also the Denver Home and Life magazine. I've been had some licensing contracts and for a book cover, and also I have a permanent installation at two of the Colorado Mountain Breweries in the Springs, and have done some contracting work with Centura Health, both for their Denver corporate offices and St. Francis Hospital. But I've always had an adventurous spirit and just absolutely love getting out in nature and just being able to share that with the rest of the world to the best of my ability. And before I start this talking about where I go for fall color, that's going to be a huge part of what I'm going to be talking about tonight, just various locations that I like to go to. And the thing that I want to emphasize is just that, especially with this day and age, with the, sorry, just trying to get my notes back up here. With this day and age, with the Instagrammers out there, and now with COVID, it seems like everybody and their brothers out doing in our natural landscapes. And I just want everybody to keep in mind that we need to be great stewards of our landscape. So I'm going to be sharing some of these places, knowing that it'll have an impact with other people going to visit these places. And I guess I'm kind of on my soapbox a little bit, just talking about how we need to protect our national forest and our national parks. And it's unfortunate, but I'm not sure if you've seen some of the photographs that have come out recently of some of the craziness that with people driving onto different landscapes or camping in areas that they shouldn't be. And it is kind of concerning. I do have a couple of photographs here. I'm just going to share. Here's one that you may have seen on Facebook of some camping. This is not a campsite. Also these, I don't know if you can see here, the tire tracks leading through the tundra and the wildflowers. And it's just disheartening to see people destroying and not realizing that it takes several years to regenerate this kind of landscape. So I guess I also wanted to emphasize a group that actually came about a year and a half to 2 years ago. It's Nature First, and it's an alliance of responsible nature photographers. And there are several photographers that have joined this mission to try to prioritize nature and the well-being of nature. So they came up with seven principles, and their website is down below. So if you're interested in finding out more information about this group and what they're all about, visit this website that I have down here. But their seven principles is to prioritize the well-being of nature over photography. And I think we just all as photographers need to realize that the shot over nature is not as important as protecting the landscape or going into private property. It's just you need to either get permission to be on private property or just not go there. Educate yourself about the places that you're going to photograph. Reflect on the possible impact of your actions and use discretion if sharing locations. And that's why the main reason why I'm kind of on the soapbox is just because I am sharing locations that are important to me. And so if you're out there, I just would hope that you'd be responsible and respectful of the landscape. Know and follow the rules and regulations. Always follow leave no trace principles and strive to leave places better than you found them. And I say like pack in and pack out all my trash, anything that I have left there. And I try to just make as little human impact as possible. Actively promote and educate others about these principles. And I just think this is important, especially with what we're seeing these days. I was up in American Basin about a month ago, and it wasn't that busy when I was up there, but then I saw some photos coming out later that people were parking off into the wildflowers and camping just wherever, and it was very crowded. So it's getting more and more crowded. So with that being said, I'll go ahead and get on with the presentation. So where to start for Colorado Fall Color? This can be different every year. It does change every year, like Dave was talking about. And last year, for example, because I tend to really take into account the weather situations that are going on at the time, I was looking at the forecast last year and it was calling for 10 days of blue sky. And as you know, as photographers, that's like a nightmare. I didn't want blue skies. I wanted clouds, and so I could have that added drama. And it was going to be really dry and the winds were horrible. And so I made in fact, it was the night before, I was seeing that up in the Tetons had gotten snow. And so I was thinking, well, maybe it's past peak up in the Tetons, but I ended up getting on their webcams and noticed that, hey, it looks really great up there. And I made that last minute split decision to go ahead and go and spend my time up at the Tetons. And I was grateful that I did, because it ended up being a beautiful time. So it can change every year, and it's hard to predict. And sometimes it will change with, it's hard to predict with what snowfall. Some people say that if the snowfall wasn't that great, it can predict, or if we haven't gotten a lot of rain, it can be a dry season, and that can affect the leaves. So I tend to go to a few different sites, and one of them is here that you could check out, smokymountains.com. And the nice thing about this is it actually gives the U.S. map, and then you can see throughout the U.S., throughout the different times when the fall color is changing. So for example, here on this first slide, it was September 17th. It looks like that was selected. So you're just seeing some changes here in Colorado. And if you look at the guide, it's showing that it is barely, you know, just starting to change color there. And then if you look over on this next photo, it looks like September 24th. And so you're seeing some more changes throughout Colorado, as well as the northern states there up in Minnesota, Wisconsin area, and the Northeast. And I go on to the next slide. And as you go up on the slider, it'll give you more and more indications, and then this nice little color chart to show you where the colors are changing. So that's one site that I've gone to help predict. Another one, there's the Colorado Fall Color Report. It's on Facebook. And if you join that group, a lot of times you'll see different reports from people, and they'll give cell phone shots of various places that they've been. Another one is Nature Photographers Network, the NPN network. If you join any of those, they talk about different places. So there's a couple of resources there. And then this little chart just shows you phase one is usually September 20th through the 30th. And that's gonna be up towards Estes Park, Breckenridge area. I've noticed some along the Front Range. Phase two is October 1st through the 10th, and you can see there in yellow, it's going to be the Gunnison, Telluride, Crested Butte area. And then phase three, October 10th, which is really pretty late, October 10th through the 20th, down in the way southern part of Colorado. Okay, so to start, and this is my route. I don't do this route every year, and it just depends. Depending on the timing and how much time I have to spend, I will do this entire route, but other times, depending on what I'm seeing on different reports, I may either skip that area if it's just going to be blue skies, and I've captured a lot of the blue sky days or whatever, and I have something in particular in mind, I might skip an area and then these are just estimated times for me and also places that I go to. But I typically go up to Rocky Mountain National Park anywhere from September 22nd through the 25th. And some of the places I like to hit are Bear Lake, Trail Ridge Road, Sprague Lake, And I also take the trail to Nymph Lake and Dream Lake, even though those areas on up to Dream Lake don't have a lot of fall color, but I'll have some pictures to illustrate. So here's just a map that I've included to show getting into the, I usually take the Beaver Meadows entrance, and here along Bear Lake Road is Sprague Lake, and then it dead ends at Bear Lake for the parking there. And then there's the trails up to Dream Lake. So here's an example of a shot that I took just above Bear Lake with Long's Peak in the background. And you can get the reflection there. This is up on Trowbridge Road, and of course Trowbridge Road doesn't have the aspens, but you can see that the tundra was changing. And so you can get the nice changing color of tundra up on Trowbridge. And if you can get a nice sunset to go along with it, this is a sunset or sunrise. This happened to be a sunset shot, but it offers a lot of nice contrasty color, I thought. Another one on Bear Lake, more of a mid-morning shot. And then also along Bear Lake, there's, if any of you have been up there, the trail that goes around is a really nice, easy trail, and it's a great place, especially with the fall color foliage, to get some abstract shots. So don't forget to look more at some intimate abstract shots. This is Sprague Lake, and there is a lot of aspens along this ridge here. So you'll be getting some fall color change that you can incorporate into your scene there too. Okay, and then this is just a shot to show you what it looks like up at Dream Lake. Dream Lake, of course, doesn't have a lot of aspens, but the grasses are starting to change, and so you can get a little bit of fall color in the foreground. And it's a nice hike. It's only a mile up to Dream Lake, and it's just kind of a nice hike after you've shot maybe morning sunrise. There's just a selfie of me there showing that there's not a lot of aspens and stuff or fall color, but it's still a nice place to hike to. This is Nymph Lake. This is about a half mile up from Bear Lake, and there's a little bit of fall color foliage. You get these lilies pads in the water, and it's just a nice scene with the reflections if it's nice and calm. Okay, so then on to about that same time frame, Breckenridge is a great area to go to. And that usually seems to peak around the 21st to 25th of September. And the two areas I tend to concentrate on if I go up there, it's kind of hard because I tend to end up going up to Rocky Mountain National Park over Breckenridge, but depending on what's happening in my life, I may end up in Breckenridge at that time. But Boreas Pass is a great area, and it offers, this is one of the shots I've taken of some aspens up there. Silverthorne area also has some nice areas, and just a map again showing where Breckenridge is. And then Boreas Pass is just off Highway 9 here as you're coming into Breckenridge from up over the pass there. So okay, so then usually the last 2 weeks of September, Twin Lakes and Independence Pass is another area that I tend to go to. I like to take this route on my way over to Aspen if I'm going to do Aspen. And so just another map showing these directions are all from Colorado Springs. So if you're coming from Denver, you'll have to do your route. But here at Twin Lakes, you can see where Independence Pass goes up and over, and it'll then take you on over to Aspen. But I love on the Aspen side, there's all these great groves of aspen trees, and then the ferns changed color below the at that time too, and it just offers some great contrast. And I've got some examples. And don't forget to get some more of the intimate shots. It doesn't have to always be about the grand landscape. I'm trying to remember that myself because I tend to shoot the grand landscape, but to incorporate some of the tree trunks with the fall color foliage at the bottom, or even some fallen leaves on the nice granite rocks there. Okay, so just a couple more examples of the aspen trees coming down Independence Pass. So then if you end up in Aspen, I usually am there between September 24th to 29th. I usually push it closer to the 29th because I'm hoping for some snowfall. And it seems like I've gotten lucky closer to the October timeframe. But it seems to peak about this time. And this is just an example of a reflection shot there. So, and here's a map showing on Highway 82, once you come into Aspen, there is a roundabout that you'll come across, and it'll be either the Maroon Creek Road exit or the Castle Creek exit. And to get up to the Bells, you'll take the Maroon Creek Road. And I'll talk about both of those here. So here it's just giving some directions at the roundabout, and it's about 10 miles up. It is one of the most photographed places in Colorado, so I highly suggest getting there early to secure a spot. Unfortunately, as of a couple of years ago, there is now a fence that it's a roped fence that they've put around the lake, and it's been quite difficult in the last couple of years to get any great reflection shots because it doesn't seem like there's been enough water that comes up close enough to the edge of where the rope is to get that. But hopefully they'll have plenty of water this year and snow maybe. Be prepared to pay an entrance fee, even though the station isn't open early in the morning. I think it's about $10. I also think that they allow, if you have a national park pass, if you put that in your front windshield, and I may be wrong on this, but what I've been told is that you can put your national park pass in your windshield and they'll accept that too. Sunrise, for I think, is the best time to shoot this scene, and usually up to a couple hours after sunrise. Sometimes right at sunrise or right before, I've noticed that the wind kicks up and ruins some of the reflection. But then once that sun comes up, I've been very lucky getting that water to really remain still, and you can get some great reflection shots. And then don't forget, there's a great trail beyond the lake. And I've spent quite a bit of time just exploring back there to get some intimate aspen shots, as well as some more close-up shots with great framing of the bells in the background. And here's just some example of what I've been able to capture over the years. This year had a lot of snow on that left-hand photo, whereas just depends on the year. And this, the year I shot this one, there was hardly any snow. And then this is just an example of hiking back on that trail and just getting a different perspective. And the other section off that roundabout, if you take the Castle Creek Road exit, that'll take you up to the little ghost town of Ashcroft, and it's about 10 miles up. And for a donation, you can walk around that little town, ghost town, and photograph the area. And it's a great place to photograph if there's a real foggy, overcast day. It can add some real drama to the little ghost town. And if they've had snow, it's just a huge bonus too. So Capitol Peak is one of my favorite places to shoot fall color. It's great as an afternoon shot and into the sunset. And so from this map, if you head out of Aspen going towards Snowmass on 82, it's about 4 miles past the Snowmass exit. And you'll be turning left onto County Road 8 and then onto County Road 11 for about a mile. And then you'll end up eventually on County Road 9, which will take you up to the Capitol Peak parking area. You will definitely need a four-wheel drive to navigate the very last section. I think most vehicles can make it up to the first landing safely. But then there is a section at the very end that is really needs four-wheel drive. And I ended up actually going late last year. Gosh, it was well into that first week, maybe second week of October, and had a huge snowfall. And unfortunately, I was a little too confident coming back down, and I have a four-wheel drive, and I had it in four low because it had quite a bit of snow. And I was just enjoying myself coming back down, and I actually started to lose control of my vehicle and slide. And I thought I was going slow enough, but then I saw some tracks that went off into a tree section, and it looked like they had actually hit the tree. Somehow I was able to gain control and avoid that tree, that whoever hit that, and came to a stop. And then I just gathered my wits about me and took my time getting down. So just be aware that if there's snow or if it's rained and it's muddy, it can be a little treacherous. So keep that in mind when you're out traveling. Here's just a couple examples. This was a blue sky night, but you can see that with that alpenglow on Capitol Peak, it still makes for a nice photo with the contrast. Here's one where I had more snow, and this was probably about an hour or two before sunset, as the lights still casting in the valley there. Okay, so I tend to leave that area. It just makes for a great route to leave kind of that Capitol Peak area and head on over to Marble for the Crystal Mill. And to back up just a little bit, when I do that Aspen area, I usually end up getting there late and staying the night and then getting up to do sunrise at the Bells. And then I'll end up doing sunset usually over at Capitol Peak. And then I'll stay over typically, and do another sunrise at the Bells, depending on the weather. And then usually after my morning shoot at the Bells, I end up heading over to Marble, because Marble is going to be it's a great afternoon into sunset shot. So from the Snowmass area, you would head over to Carbondale on 82 and then get on to 133 heading to Marble. And I kind of explain this here a little bit. So it's the access to the mill is approximately 6 miles from the little town of Marble, and you can drive back a little further, and some people park a little further back, and instead of taking the small narrow road to get back to the mill, some people, I've seen several people either bike in with their bicycles or hike in and hike out. I've always just taken my four-wheel drive back there. Here's just some more detailed instructions. As you leave Marble, you'll pass Beaver Lake on the right. And then at the top of the hill, it'll lead you into Lead King Basin. And you'll pass Lizard Lake on your left. And then the road becomes steep and narrow and rough. And it does. It's not hard. It's not a difficult drive back there. But it is very narrow, and there's some steep sections, and it's very rocky. It's extremely bumpy. And a lot of sections, it's just one way. So you need to be aware of the pullouts and be prepared to back up to make room to pass. Especially if it's busy, I highly recommend not going on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I recommend going earlier in the week. I've noticed it gets really busy. And also just remember the four-wheel drive rules apply. The person coming up has the right of way. I was just there to do a summer shot of the Bells. And unfortunately, as I'm heading in, I noticed some people hiking out, and they looked very concerned. And they said somebody had just rolled their truck up ahead. And apparently, two guys were in a truck, and they decided that they didn't want to get their truck scratched up, and there was some tree branches or some bushes that were sticking out, and so they got a little close too close to the edge, and they ended up rolling their truck. It was very unfortunate. I didn't see it. Must have happened maybe a half hour before I'd gotten there, because apparently, and they were fine. They both jumped from the truck before it completely rolled down the side of the hill. But and here's some pictures that I took. It was on June 10th, this last just a couple months ago. Ended up in the river. Their truck ended up in the river. They were able to get out unscathed, and some people took them back into Marble to get help. But just to show you that things can happen back there. It's like I said, you just have to be very careful. And they were just trying to avoid getting their truck scratched, and unfortunately, they rolled it. So just be careful and take your time going back there. Here's just some examples of some shots that I've taken at the mill. And here you can see where the river nicely flows right past the mill. Before I get into McClure Pass, just another note, this has become such a popular area that the owners are really being very protective of this. And they have a rope that's up along the road here as you're at the mill, and they do patrol it quite frequently, and they have somebody there usually. If you want to go down to the river, you are trespassing, but they are there, and if you make a donation, I forget how much they're asking for a donation, and to sign a waiver, they'll let you down onto to hike in the river area. Apparently, there was some lady a few years back that was wearing high heels, and she sprained her ankle or got herself into trouble back there, and had threatened to sue. I don't know if she what happened with that, but anyway, I think that's why and it's become so popular. The other thing that when I was talking to the owner one of the times I was down there, there was an incident, and I don't remember how many years ago this was, but he had been patrolling it and fortunately had shown up just in time to see there was a truck that had put his tow rope and connected it to the mill and was getting ready to pull the mill down. And the owner asked him, "Why are you doing that?" And the guy said, "Oh, just because I want to see it fall." And the owner started talking to him and saying, "This is private property, and what the that it was a federal offense, and that if you do this," he ended up fortunately talking the guy out of pulling the mill down. But it's just crazy. And also, the door apparently got knocked out by some that was vandalized, and they've put a lot of money into reinforcing the structure because it's such an icon. But it's just sad to see, and I understand why they have to be so protective of the area. It's been in their family for years. But anyway, moving on. From there, I like to go up over McClure Pass on Highway 133, and it's a beautiful drive up over McClure, and there's many turnouts with great views of the Sweeping Valley and aspens along the way. At the very top of the pass, too, there's a pullout, and if you cross the highway, there's a great grove of aspens in there that I've spent some time just getting some shots of aspen trunks with the ferns in front. This was a blue sky day, but you can just, this is an example of what it looks like from the top of the pass. Okay, I then go on over to Kevler Pass. So I take Colorado 133 from McClure Pass and turn onto County Road 12, which is Kevler Pass. And I think I show it here. You can see Kevler Pass from this side coming on in from, that's coming in from 133. And it's beautiful. On the west side, there's great sunsets that happen. I have an example of that. There's the Marcellina Mountain. It's a beautiful white rocky mountain and has a nice great grove of aspens below, and it's fun to shoot. Don't forget to go to Lost Lake on the way. It's a great lake that you can get reflections of the east and west Beckwith Mountains. And just a note that Kepler Pass is very passable with a regular car. It can get washboardy in spots, but it's very doable with just a regular car. Kepler Pass is about 30 miles long, and it takes you all the way to Crested Butte if you want to go that far. So here's just, this is a west sunset shot that I took, panoramic there. This is just some examples on Lost Lake and the reflections. Fortunately, I had had a nice snowfall. And then heading towards Crested Butte, you'll come across Torch Branch Park. And just a note, there's two bathrooms that I know of along this route. One is at Lost Lake because there's a campground there at Lost Lake. And there's actually one at Horse Ranch Park. So just an FYI. So once you get to Horse Ranch Park, if you look north, you'll see what is called the dike. It's the wall of rocky formations with the amazing sprawling aspens below, and it never disappoints. The best time to shoot this area is the third to the last week in September. And I usually shoot this scene at sunset for the front lighting, but you can also shoot it at sunrise. I tend to shoot more at sunset though at this spot. And here's just a couple examples of some shots that I've gotten in past years. Okay, and heading just a little further on the Kepler Pass, there's the East Beckwith Mountain, and it's on the east side of Kepler Pass. And there's some beaver ponds that you'll come across, and I kind of like those in the foreground. And don't forget to put on your telephoto lens too and get some telephoto shots. It makes for some, especially when there's clouds and nice fog in the snow that happened that year. You can get some great telephoto shots. Okay, so Ohio Pass is you can access Ohio Pass in two ways. You can There's actually a junction that you'll cross on Kepler Pass, and you can access Ohio Pass that way. Or from the Gunnison side, if you didn't come that route and you come through Gunnison, it's about a mile north of Gunnison. One of my favorite overlooks in this spot is the Castles Formation at the top of the pass. And also just take time as you're coming up from either going to the Gunnison side or coming up from the Gunnison side. There's great aspen groves along the way with the white trunks and the foliage underneath. So here's just some examples. This is the castle formation I was talking about. This is a panoramic I did from the top of the pass, and then just a telephoto shot here on the lower right hand side that I took. Then here's an example of the aspens with the ferns below. Okay, just another example, the aspens with the ferns. Okay, and then if you head into Crested Butte, you can get on Gothic Road, and it's a beautiful drive back on Gothic. And this is from the town of Crested Butte. You'll head north on Gothic Road or Forest Road 317. There's many overlooks and opportunities along the way. And eventually you'll come to the little town of Gothic. And I've gone through this area, and it's just great to get some roadside shots. And also the little town of Gothic offers some great buildings to shoot too. Okay, this is actually from the town of Gothic here up in the upper left-hand corner, and then just an example of what I've shot from the road. Okay, so the other area I like to go to is the Silver Jack Reservoir and Owl Creek Pass down towards Southwest Colorado. And from Gunnison, I take Highway 50 passing Blue Mesa Reservoir. And don't forget to the scrub oak. There's been several times where I've either been in the San Juans shooting fall color and it's a blue sky day. And so I'll head back over to the Blue Mesa area where there's amazing scrub oak. And because it's a blue sky day, you can get some great abstract shots, and of the scrub oak, it's just a plethora of color that time of year. And it's fun to kind of just use your time wisely and do some more intimate shots. So, and if you have time, sometimes I'll do this right, depending on when I'm, the time of day I'm coming over towards Ridgeway, consider taking the Cimarron Road to Silver Jack Reservoir. And then from Silver Jack, you can take Owl Creek Pass coming into the Ridgeway area. And it takes some time, but it's a beautiful route. And you'll see some great, there's some great scenic pullouts, and Silver Jack Reservoir offers a great scene as well as that surrounding area. Let's see. And then as you're coming down Owl Creek Pass, there are the grand vistas of Courthouse Mountain and Chimney Rock along the way. I'll show you an example of that. And then the Cimarrons, of course, following up our site to see. So here's a shot of a selfie of me at Silver Jack Reservoir, and a nice map on the right just showing the different areas. This is the Cimarron Road I was talking about here to get to up to Silver Jack, and then that turns into Owl Creek that will take you down into the Ridgeway area. This is up by Silver Jack Reservoir also. Some just rock formations that you can get some shots of. Same with this one. This is also up by Silver Jack. And then here's Courthouse Rock and Chimney Peak. This is where True Grit, the John Wayne movie, was one of the scenes was filmed right here. It's a very famous area. And this was taken at sunset. The nice thing about sunset here at this location, and this picture doesn't depict it very well. I ended up processing this actual scene because of the way the clouds were moving in and out. But as the sun sets, these rock formations get the amazing alpine glow on these rocks and can turn like a deep orangish red color, which is really fantastic. And then on the way down Owl Creek Pass, there's opportunities to pull out and see some great aspens with the fall foliage below. And this happens to be on Owl Creek Pass too. Doesn't look like a fall shot. It was actually taken during the fall, but it was had a very heavy snow, and I happened to see this scene with the sun peeking through and was able to get the sun flare coming through the trees there. This is on the other side of Owl Creek, on the Ridgeway side, and it's got great vistas of the aspens and the rock formations above. Some more of the Cimarrons, the great color, just the layers of colors that you'll see there, witness. And then there's a vista point overlook on Owl Creek Pass, and that's where I shot this scene. It happened to be in Ridgeway. It was completely socked in. I couldn't even see the San Juan mountain range. It's just that San Juan mountain range here with some snuffles there. But I got up, I decided to go ahead and go, it looked like it would be interesting up on Owl Creek. So I got above the clouds basically, and it was just amazing watching these clouds move in and out of the scene. So keep that in mind too. I do that a lot on my shoots. I look at the weather forecast. I look at what the conditions are going to be like. And sometimes I wish I could be at five places at once, but I'm always just anticipating what the weather's going to be doing. I look at the, try to look at the forecast. I use some of my apps that I have to predict what kind of sunrise or sunset I'm going to have in an area, and plan accordingly. And so hopefully I can be at the right place at the right time, depending on what I'm mapping out. So the San Juans, I usually go the last few days of September into the first 2 weeks of October. It's my favorite location to shoot fall color. There's so many possibilities and so many locations. I usually either stay overnight. I do a lot of car camping, so I usually like to stay close to the Ridgeway area or Ouray, somewhere in that area, because I can base out a lot of my locations from there. There's various colors of yellow, orange, and reds, along with the array of colors of the scrub oak, that make it for a glorious must-see location. It's every time I go back there, I'm just in awe of what I'm witnessing. And on overcast days, take the opportunity to capture intimate scenes like aspen trunks. There was one day that it was raining, so just raining all day, raining or snowing all day, and I had just a great time going and getting the rich colors because of the wet leaves and the snow on the ground of just different aspens and stuff, because it was completely socked in. This is Dallas Divide. This is one of the easiest places to shoot in the area. There's a huge pull out at the top of the divide. And if you take Highway 62 just west out of Ridgeway, it's only about 8 miles outside of Ridgeway. And to the top of the pass, near the top, there's a parking lot off to the left-hand side. It is private property up there past the fence line. So just beware of the private property on both sides of the highway. I do prefer to shoot this scene at sunrise, but I've also seen it with gray clouds in late afternoon and some possibilities at sunset. I usually arrive early because this seems to get very crowded also in the mornings. And I've seen a lot of workshop groups showing up at this spot too, as well as, you know, the bells, of course. But here's just some examples of shots I've gotten at the top of the divide there. Okay, so some of the county roads, there's like three county roads that I tend to go to along the highway there. One of them is County Road 5. It used to be called Girl Scout Road. I usually go there the first week of October. And this is accessed at the very west end of Ridgeway. You can turn south on Amelia Street and your next right will be onto County Road 5. It's the road is a little rough, but doable by car until the last section. The last section can be a little more rough, especially if there's been snow or rain in the area. But there's a great, once you get back to that back section, you can see part of the divide. Actually, you can see most of the divide. But there's a great shot of area to shoot Mount Sniffles and the range here. And they have it's a wonderful group of aspens in that area. So here's just some examples of what I've captured over the years. This was Blue Hour. There weren't that many clouds, but you can still get the magical Blue Hour. And then I'm always looking for the clouds and the great sunset. So always looking at my weather options there. This is a foggy day and it had just rained, and so it offers some great contrasty colors. County Road 7, or also called East Dallas Creek Road, is about 4 miles on off of Highway 62. It'll be a left-hand turn as you're heading out of Ridgeway. And the best views for that, I think, are the best views are about 6 miles up the road through a lot of switchbacks. And then you'll come across the scene with the aspens and Mount Sniffles in the background. And I guess I had just included here that you'll head up through the Ralph Lauren Ranch along the way, but you're allowed to drive through there. It's just be aware that it is private property along the way. I think this is the best as a mid-morning, in the mid-morning light or the early evening into sunset. And this was a sunset shot there. Just some more examples of that same area. If you drive a little bit further back, you can get the full bowl here, which is nice. And this, there's a bunch of scrub oak that changed color here. And there's also a pond back, and I don't think I have any photos of the pond, but there's a pond a little further back that you can get some reflection shots in. Okay, so then County Road 9 is a little further up. It's about 5 miles west of Ridgeway, and it's also a left-hand turn. And it's only about, there's only about a 1 mile distance between County Road 7 and County Road 9. And there's various places along the way to get some great compositions and some light. I think this is the best mid-morning shot, or I've shot up here at sunset. Here's a sunset shot that I did. Almost did not make this scene. I was over in Telluride that day, and it was a clear blue day. I was really frustrated, and I kept thinking, well, I was getting reports from some apps that maybe the Divide was going to have a good sunset, or some clouds were starting to develop. So I was kind of just nonchalantly making my way back up to the top of Dallas Divide area, and it was getting really close to sunset. And as I got to the top of Divide, I still wasn't seeing great clouds. And then all of a sudden I look a little further and there were gray clouds. It looked like, from what I could see, over Mount Sniffles. And I had to determine, I thought, well, maybe I just stay at the top of the Divide and shoot, because I was very limited on time. And I thought, maybe I have enough time to get down to County Road 9 and get back up there. And so I raced down there and was able to get up to the scene with 5 minutes to spare, and I was able to capture the sunset. And I was so grateful that I made that choice. But sometimes it is a split second decision. I always try to go where the light is. I'm chasing the light all the time and looking at the forecast and seeing if I, you know, using my eyes too. I mean, I don't just rely on my apps. I'm really looking at what's going on Owl Creek. I can usually see, you can see Owl Creek from the top of the Divide, and I'm always anticipating, okay, should I head over there for sunset or sunrise? Same thing with the Telluride side, looking at the clouds and knowing the weather patterns in that area and just trying to really anticipate where the action is going to be. Okay, so here's I gave my information here because it was, there weren't that many clouds. This is also on County 9. There weren't that many clouds that night, but they were moving really fast. So I thought, well, maybe I'll do a long exposure just to get the movement of the clouds, to have something a little different and a little interesting. So I shot this at 30 seconds at F11. ISO was 180 millimeters. And this is also on County 9, mid-morning shot there on the right-hand side. One of the other areas I like to explore is Last Dollar Road. And this area is also that first or second week of October seems to be the best. It's one of my favorite roads from the top of the Dallas Divide. And it'll actually take you, if you take the complete loop, it'll take you over to the Telluride area. And it's if you do that, it's approximately 21 miles. So just at the top of the Divide on Highway 62, you'll pass the top of the Divide and turn left onto Last Dollar Road. Okay. And here's just a shot of Mount Wilson in the background with some great light that was coming through. It's fun as both a late afternoon or just after sunrise. I like to go on this road. It can be a rough road, and it can especially be intimidating after a rain or snow. I know I had started to head back. Oh, this has been a couple of years ago, just right after a really terrible rain, and I started slipping around in the mud quite a bit, and I just made the choice to turn around and not get myself into trouble back there. So just be aware of the road and the weather conditions. But you can get great views of the Wilson Mason, Wilson Peak. And like I said, it'll eventually take you over to Telluride area. And here's just some more examples of that. Just some other scenes that you can get. This is closer to the Telluride side. And another option is Woods Lake. Woods Lake is, if you don't, it's actually on the way, I'm just checking my time here, on the way to Telluride also, but taking the highway. So from the top of the divide, if you stay on Highway 62, you'll get to 145 and take a left there. And this will take you towards Telluride. And it'll take you to the little town of Sawpit. But just before getting to that little town, there'll be a right-hand turn on Fall Creek Road or FR 618, and that'll take you up to Woods Lake. And it's about 9 miles to get up to the lake. And I think this place is the best for afternoon shots. And also look for abstracts at the lake. So here's just some examples over the years. This part here on the left with the aspen trees is a great spot if you have a telephoto to get some great abstracts. One of the other places I like to go to is Trout Lake, and that's heading towards Telluride on Highway 145. But instead of going into the town of Telluride, take the roundabout southwest. And there are many scenic pullouts along the way to Trout Lake. There's Sunshine Mountain to the south. The aspens along that stretch are just amazing. I've gotten some road shots with the aspens. And then once you get to Trout Lake, you'll see that you can actually park down by the lake. And this one was shot just from the parking lot. You can get really close to the water, and I took some. This is a panoramic I took there, so, and that's usually around the first week of October also. Okay, so before I get into that, I was just going to mention that, like I said, this is just my simple route that I like to travel, and it just depends on how much time you have, but it gives you a lot of options. And I do like to explore. There's a lot of county roads in that area, especially as you head towards Telluride. And I just encourage you to explore as long as it's, not private property, but to get off the beaten path and look at different options for yourself and make your scene unique. Okay. So there's the end of that. I was just going to talk a little bit about how just a couple of techniques that I use when I'm doing post-processing. And I've done a lot more with panoramics. So I just thought I would briefly share some detail about how I go about stitching together photos for panoramics. And some people ask, why would you want to create a panoramic image? One that I used today was if you didn't have your wide angle lens and you're not able to get the whole scene in the photo, think panoramic. I was shooting a waterfall this morning, and I about hiked back to my car to get my wide angle lens, but decided, oh yeah, this would make actually a great vertical panorama. And so I was able to take three different vertical, well, they were horizontal shots, but I'm going to stitch them together as a vertical shot. So I took three photos to get that whole waterfall in the scene. And that's an option if you have just your medium telephoto or a long range. And it makes the impact, especially with mountains, if you can use a long range lens and or a medium telephoto lens, a lot of times if you stitch together a panoramic, it can make the impact of the mountains, especially in the background, not look so small. Whereas I've noticed if you shoot with a wide, a super wide angle lens as just a single shot, sometimes that those mountains in the background can look quite small. So I've used the panoramic. Also with a panoramic, with stitching those images together in either a 2:3 format, 1:3 or 1:2 format makes for a very large file, which if you're going to print large prints for clients or for galleries or whatever, it's nice to have that huge file. Precaution is to take off your polarizer. It can mess up your scene because a lot of times the sky can have variations in the sky and will lead to a nightmare when trying to blend during the stitching process. And there's ways to correct it, but it's very time consuming in my opinion to do that post process. I use both vertical capture and horizontal capture for stitching my photographs. Of course, your image is to be a horizontal image. A series of vertical captures will include more of the top and bottom of the image, creating more information to work with, meaning if you need to crop out a section either on the top or the bottom, you'll have more to work with when doing that. I shoot in manual exposure. This also includes using manual focus on my lens. As you pan from left to right or top to bottom, the likelihood of exposure variation is high. Therefore, shooting in manual mode where your settings won't adjust for every image is critical. I expose for my initial shot and then I bracket. I often bracket the rest of my series of shots to have the pick of what exposure I want to use when later stitching my panoramic. And it depends on the light variation in your scene too, if you feel like you need to bracket your shot. A level tripod is critical, as well as a level camera. I use a panel head that keeps my camera level during shooting my panel. This makes my life so much easier when I'm trying to stitch together in Photoshop. The white balance, I often use just the auto white balance, or you can manually set the color temperature or the Kelvin temperature manually, depending on the scene. You can also use a lot of cameras have the cloudy daylight, etc. On the cameras. I always shoot in RAW in case I need to make adjustments in post-processing. So be leery of using a wide-angle lens unless you do at least an 80 to 90% overlap when you're doing your shots. There will be issues with the wide-angle distortion. It's best to use the short telephoto or medium wide lenses for best results. I often use my 24-105 or the 70-200 millimeter lenses, and I've gotten really great results with those two lenses. You can use a cable release or a 2-second timer on your camera to avoid camera shake. And then overlap in general is suggested to do at least 30% overlap, but I end up out of habit just doing a 50% overlap for my panoramics. So just a quick example of my process. I didn't want to have to pull Photoshop up, so I've just made some screenshots of what I've done in lieu of time. I have imported my photos into Lightroom, or a lot of people like to use Bridge, so whatever program you're wanting to use to import your photos. And then I go through and I select which images I'm going to use to stitch together. And I've shown that here. And then after selecting, this is in Photoshop, in Lightroom, by the way. So from Lightroom, I select a photo at the top. And then I edit in and merge to Panorama in Photoshop. And that will take me then to Photoshop. And then it gives you these options. It'll pull up your images here, or these files. And then you have all these different options. And this is just, I mean, you can play around with this program if you haven't already and see what works best for you. And sometimes it just depends on the images that you're stitching together. I've had to play around with these different modes to get the best result and the best lineup of my stitching. But in the layout mode, I usually select perspective or cylindrical. And then at the bottom, there's a photo merge dialog box, and you can select your choices and then click OK. I have brief descriptions on what these mean at the bottom. I tend to do blend images together, and then I do usually select vignette removal and geometric distortion correction. I usually leave the content aware fill transparent areas unchecked, because I like to do this manually, and I'll show you how I go about doing that. But it's up to you if you want to play around with that. So once, after the images are stitched together in Photoshop, your rendered image will appear, and the photos used for the panoramic will appear as masks and layers, which is nice because then you can click on and off these different layers and zoom way in to your image to see how well it's stitched together. I just said that. Your file will be huge, so I tend to flatten my image at this point so that I have a more workable file. And then I crop the image for the best composition. And I usually, like this image, I believe I cropped at a 2-to-1 ratio. And so there's the cropping, and this is the final image. Yeah, it was a 2-to-1 panoramic that I did. So after the post-processing, this is what that image turned out to look like. Okay, so fixing the white edges after stitching. This is how I like to do that, and everybody probably does it a little different, but this is just a technique that I like to do. So with this image, again, you can select and deselect to see how this stitched together. And then I make a background copy of the image. So make a background copy. And then I go to edit, transform, and then distort. And then from here, I call it the windshield wiper icon up at the top of the screen. And the warp and transform modes are selected. So then you can take these points here and move them up and to get, or over to get rid of those white areas. And then I flatten the image again and crop to the desired size. And then that's the final image there. Okay. And then let's see how much time we have here. I might briefly just go over a couple, the last few techniques as creating a sunburst. I've been asked a lot how you go about creating a sunburst. So the number one suggestion is to use a small aperture. I tend to shoot at f16 or f22. The smaller the aperture, the more pronounced the effect you will get. And it's really experimenting with the lenses that you have too, and it'll determine your kind of sweet spot for the ideal star effect with the f-stop that you use. And before having, beware of having a filter on your lens. This may interfere with getting the desirable effect. I always just remove my polarizer, make sure my polarizer isn't on there. I mask out the light by partially blocking the light from the sun with a tree, leaves, mountain, building, etc., to give you a more dramatic star effect. The closer you are to the light that is producing the star effect, the larger the star effect will be in your frame. And like I said, practice and experiment with different compositions for an appealing photo. So here's just a couple of examples. This is on that one on Elk Creek Pass. This is Ohio Pass, but just kind of getting that sun flare. And just the information here, I shot this at F16. The one on the right was at F22. It's just another example. This was shot at F16. Okay, I think this is the last technique I talk about is experimenting with panning to create the abstract landscape. When done correctly, these images can have a great artistic quality and resemble paintings in a way. And so panning photography is all about the correct choice of the shutter speed. The aperture and ISO values do not play that major of a role. You can use shutter priority mode. I tend to set my exposures manually, but this might help you. I use a tripod to ensure that the movement is straight rather than choppy. And you'll want to use a slow shutter speed, somewhere between a half a second and 4 seconds usually works well for me. But I've had to experiment, especially given the light conditions. And if it's really a bright day, sometimes I'll add a filter on the front so that it can use a longer shutter speed. So I start by focusing on an area at the base of the subject, and then I slowly move my camera up, and it's called panning. So I slowly pan up the camera as I I release the shutter, and then I start panning up, stopping once I'm at the top of the subject. And you can experiment with this depending on how many seconds or you have will determine how long of a movement you have also, because that determines how long your shutter is open. But it's fun. I'll spend like up to 2 hours sometimes just experimenting with different colors of aspen trees or there's various things that you can do panning with, but I tend to do them with the aspen trees, and it does take some experimenting. If your images are coming out overexposed, use a small aperture like F16 or a neutral density filter to block some of the light. And I consider usually on an overcast day works well, or late afternoon when the light is lower. So here's just some examples of what I've shot in the past. So here was a 1 second shot on the left, and it shows you what result I got there. And then I did 1/10 of a second here. And it's all about the movement too, just the how fast you go. And it's fun experimenting with the different results that you can get. So that's really the end of my program. I've just included some resources out there that I've used in the past. John Fielder's book, Best of Colorado, some of his maps I actually used for this program, and I got permission from him to do so. But this book is just filled with all different great details, down to hotels and places to eat in different areas of Colorado and places to shoot. So highly recommend that resource. I've also used Andy Cook's book, Colorado's Best Photography Locations. And I also got permission from him to use some of his maps and information on this program. When I was starting out shooting Southwest Colorado, I used this quite a bit for some locations. And it doesn't include just fall color locations, but spring and summer, stuff like that. So it's a great resource. Here's my information. Follow me on Facebook, and there's my Facebook page. You can also find me at fineartbywendy.com or wendygadak.com. And my email address and my phone number if you have any questions. I love helping other photographers, and if you want to email me, text me, whatever, I'll answer your questions to the best of my ability. And just a little teaser, next year I'm going to be helping out with some storm chasing. I have a friend photographer that is involved in storm chase tours, and I've been asked to help with that, along with some other professional photographers. And this is the website, stormchasetour.net. So check that out. So I am going to stop share so that, let's see if that'll work. Get back here to the group. All right.
Wendy, hi, this is Dave. Hey, I greatly appreciate your program. It was nice to kind of take a tour around Colorado with you. And I think you struck a wonderful balance between sharing locations without saying, okay, go to this GPS coordinate and whatever. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like, here's this area. You go figure out where you want to go, you know, depending on the light and what is appealing to you. So I thank you for that. Many of your images, I just went, wow. I mean, so good thing I was muted. So, but I mean, you know, the Capitol Peak area for one was just marvelous.
You
really captured the sense of that area. Kind of sad, you know, the Crystal River Mill, that story, that kind of bummed me out of the way that things are changing and why people feel like they just want to attach, you know, cable and pull it over just to see what happens. I, you know, that's kind of a sad commentary, but maybe that's just reality anymore.
Right.
And thank you very much so much for, you know, going into the pano tips, not only of as you're capturing, but also how you process. I mean, that was wonderful. You really got into that.
Okay.
And, you know, just this, you know, this abstract of intentional camera movement, I thought that was wonderful. So I thank you for, you know, taking time on the road to share some of your thoughts with us and to do your travel on. So,
okay.
I would like to open it up. I'm sure other people have questions for you, so people can unmute themselves either through the little button, through the icon, or press and hold the space bar. So.
Okay.
Recently, I read somewhere that there is a group trying to raise money to buy the Crystal Mill because the landowner is thinking about selling it, and it will probably become some rich person's hideaway if it's not sold and saved.
Yeah, I've not heard of that. I did talk to the, when I was there in June, that's when I found out about the story about the guy with the truck and the cable. And he shared that information with me. He was giving me some kind of background history of how it's been family owned since he was a child, actually, and grew up in that area. And he's from Texas, actually, now that he and his family live in Texas, but they come back up every summer to kind of run the cabins that are just close by. And but he, you know, I asked him about the future, and he didn't give me a detail, but he had mentioned that maybe there were some either groups that are raising money. And I thought he had mentioned that making it a national, some kind of landmark, and I can't remember the name of the group, but so I hate to put it out there and be wrong, but some group that might be taking it over, which if that were the case, I felt like it was more of a preservation type of thing, but which I would hope.
I think that whatever this group was, and I don't remember the name either, that was what they were aiming at, to prevent it being sold to somebody who was going to tear the mill down.
Right. And I got that impression from him too, when I talked to him, that it was some group that was hopefully going to be taking it over if their family decided to do that and preserve it, which would be great.
Wendy, this is Dave again. I have a question for you. Many of your aspen trunks were just kind of like Snow White.
Yeah.
So many of I go out and they're kind of like a yellowish color.
Yes.
Do you have any tips and tricks how to, I mean, change that specific color for the aspen trunks, or are you just luckier than I am to come across these beautiful white aspen?
No, I've actually experienced the same thing. And to be very honest, seriously, those sections, there's been a couple of sections where I find them that I feel like they're that white. I mean, in fact, it kind of stops me in my tracks when I see them. Specifically on Owl Creek Pass, there's a small section there. And then also on Owl Creek, or oh, not Owl Creek, I just said that. On Ohio Pass, as you're coming on the Gunnison side, there's a section there that's very stark white. And I've just been very drawn to those. A couple, there's one section on Independence Pass also that I found that they're more white for whatever reason. And so I'm very drawn to that because most areas that I go to too, especially along Kevler Pass and stuff like that, where I've looked, there's a few areas that I found some really white ones. I found some this summer with the ferns that were really green, but other than that, they are looking kind of haggard. But yeah, I've been kind of lucky just, and I think maybe just white balance a little bit on the cooler side helps a little bit with that too. So.
Okay, well, I appreciate that. I'll send you a $20 bill for those GPS coordinates
Yeah, okay.
then.
I love it. Oh, I was trying to read the side notes if there's any questions here. Oh, yeah. Okay, good. Look at that. Weather apps. I do use, somebody asked about weather apps, and I do use AccuWeather as one of them. It gives some pretty good detail about what's going on. There's another, and it's the photographer's Ephemeris. I have a plug-in to that that's, it's, I gotta pull it up here because I'm having a brain freeze. But I use it all the time too. It's Skyfire. It's kind of a plug-in on the TPE app, the photographer's Ephemeris. And what Skyfire does, and I really like it, I can add my favorite locations, and I have a ton of them in here. And it'll give you a 3-day forecast, and it goes through and does a lot of the satellite imagery in any particular area, and it will predict, and it gives like a percentage too. So, for example, today in Ridgeway, there was a 50% chance for a good sunrise and a 50% chance for a good sunset. Tomorrow there's 0 and 0. So I tend to use that app a lot, and it's a real simple way. I have some good friends that I travel with that use some great satellite apps to actually look at the satellite imagery. And I can do that a little bit on AccuWeather, but I do tend to use the Skyfire quite a bit to predict. And again, it's only 3 days out, but and it gives updates throughout the day. So I tend to use that. I don't know if that helps. Oh, there's the foundation somebody listed for, and then comments for the Crystal Mill Foundation.
Yeah, I just did. This is Carl. I'm the webmaster and newsletter guy. I just did a quick search for in Google to see what kind of foundation or what kind of organization was doing anything for the mill, and that's the first thing that popped up.
Yeah. Good. Yeah. I guess they must be taking donations on that site too. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it looks like they're trying. They've got 5 million. They're trying to get to 10, or
Okay.
something. They're hoping to. I just did a quick read of it. It looks like they're trying to get everything settled by next year.
Oh, good. I think it needs something because, like I said, what did he tell me? There was during fall color last year, it was a Saturday or Sunday, and he counted, what was he telling me, like 700 cars that ended up back there. I mean, during the day, throughout the day, there were 700 cars that came to the mill. And that's just That just seems insane to me because I've been back there several times and I haven't run into that much traffic, fortunately, because it is very difficult in sections to pass. So I can't imagine. I know that a lot of those little ATV guys have become really popular and I have seen a lot of those back there too, but it's something needs to happen.
I don't know if anybody else has any more comments through the chat of questions about techniques or anything. I haven't seen any. But I do applaud you for, you know, kind of bringing up this Nature's First, if that was the right website, about, you know, what's our responsibility, you know, as photographers to maybe not totally share locations and protect, you know, protect the things that we love to go out and photograph. So it becomes this challenge as more and more people are getting out into these areas.
I think so. Yep. And I think as photographers, and me included, I found out some of the locations to people that trust and know that who I am and have shared either taking me there or shared locations, knowing that I wasn't going to be damaging the area or just, I think the important thing too is just not blasting it on social media. I mean, I'm very general usually about, especially if I'm pretty protective of a spot, if I post process something and I put it on my Facebook page, I can be pretty vague about where I've taken it. If I start getting questions, I ask them to either message me or that kind of thing instead of just blasting out a location, because I know some areas have been pretty protected. So,
well, I just wanted to say thank you for addressing that. It's important as all of us go out into the hitherlands to get our fall colors, you know, images for the competition that you will be judging for us on November 25th.
That'd be great. Thanks. Definitely.
Well, Wendy, thank you very much for joining us. I know you're traveling, so I wish you safe journeys, you know, not only in, you know, in Washington, but also happy trails and a safe journey home.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And I appreciate being able to do the presentation for everybody. And if you have questions after this, just let me know. You have my email and phone number and all that. So feel free to send me a note and I'll try to get back with you.
Thank you, Wendy, for a wonderful program. And with that, I bid you good night.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Wendy. That's great.
Thanks. Bye, everybody.